Hello everyone, my name is Vijay Janakiraman, along with my colleague Anuradha. We are going to talk about ensuring site reliability using security controls. So first thing, when we talk about site, what exactly it is? When you say site, it's basically the website, what we have developed or what we are going to give it for our customers, and the APIs, what we have developed for our customers, right? Only these two are what we call it as site. And we call it as, when we call something as site reliability, what exactly it is? It is basically the high availability of our site for the legitimate customers. That is what is site availability. If you want to ensure high availability of your site, then we have to make sure our databases, our VMs, network, everything is optimally used. That's how we'll make our systems highly available. So this will have two aspects to it, right? One is the capacity. So we actually provision our databases, VMs, networks based on the traffic which we get today to our sites. But we all know that there is always good traffic and there is always a bad traffic also. So when we do the provisioning or the capacity for our systems, right, we actually knowingly or unknowingly, we are doing the provisioning for the bad traffic also. And also, other point, the second one, the site outages, right? What are all reasons the site outages can happen? Like, there will be a lot of internal reasons, like our databases can choke, hypervisors can go for failure, the developer can put a bad code and all those things. But externally, if an attacker wants to just bring down our site, right, he can just bombard our site with multiple calls in a short span of time and he can bring down the site. So when we talk about this bad traffic or the malicious traffic, right, what are all the motivations behind? Why would someone do all these things, right? Why are people attacking the site? There are two major reasons to this. Right? One is the pride. In the dark web, right, when someone says like, oh, I have brought down so-and-so site for 5 minutes or 1 hour or 24 hours, right? It's a great pride for them in the dark web. That is one thing. The other one is the money. So people steal the account credentials and then get into their get into their accounts and then try to steal the financial details, right? That's another thing. So if you see all these things, right, the bad traffic, the malicious traffic, right, it is all bot or automated traffic. Just by a human sitting with a computer and then by doing multiple clicks, he cannot bring down a site. He cannot create an availability impact. He can cross a security impact, but not an availability impact. So we all understand that this is automated and bot traffic. That is what is causing all these issues, right? So now, what if there is a way, there is an effective way to stop this entire automated malicious traffic out of our system? If we make that out of our system, that's going to keep our systems highly available and in turn, highly reliable. So that's what we are going to see today. With that, I'll move to the agenda. So in the starting, we'll see like how the global internet traffic looks like. And then we'll talk about one of the very effective defense mechanism to stop or mitigate this malicious traffic away from our site. And then what are the detection strategies which we can have in the system to do that? And what are all the mitigation strategies for that? Moving on. So this is from the internet we have taken this picture. So you can see this is as of 2018, 20% of total internet traffic is from the bad bots. And there are a lot of actors here, impersonators who basically tries to impersonate someone, like basically the account credential theft or whatever, right? And then scrapers, so which basically scrape some information from your site and then use it for an illegitimate use. And then spammers who spam your site, and then hacker tools which hacks your site and then get some legitimate information, right? And there are some good bots also. I'm not going to talk about the good bots here. We need the good bots anyway. We need them for the crawlers and the search engine optimization and all those stuff, right? We need them. So now, this 20% rate, I'm sure this is going to go up in the coming up years because the attackers are becoming more and more sophisticated. And as the technology grows, they have a lot of ways to basically do these attacks. So there is some attacks which can happen from the humans also, but as I said, it will not create an availability impact. Here we are talking about the availability perspective of this, not the security perspective. Oh, sorry. Okay. Yep. Yeah. So this is a more drilled down version of what I showed in the first slide. You can see here, though we say like 20% is the bad bot traffic, some of the sweet ones, right, like for the attackers, the financial ones or the ticketing ones, right, it's even like 40% is the bad traffic. So you can see here, right, the capacity or the provisioning, what we have done and how much we are running the VMs, databases, and all those things, right, we are keeping this 40% also into our systems. That's what this shows, right? So the intent here is that it's not only 20%, it's really high with some sectors, right? That's what I want to stress here. With that, let's move on. Let's see a very simple, very high-level look of how calls come from internet and then it reaches our application zone. So from internet, it basically any company will have some level of network layer protection will be there. I'm sure they'll have some level of network layer protection, which will basically do some packet level analysis, and then they will try to stop the bad traffic. And then it reaches the layer 7 router or the load balancer, whatever it is. Many companies use a router and then load balancers. So these routers are the ones which basically, based on the incoming URL or whatever, it basically routes the request to the particular application. So most of us here we don't have monolithic applications, right? We have like distributed applications, multiple applications doing different functions. So the routers will basically route to the actual applications. So that's where this layer 7 app defense comes in place. So this is an application defense mechanism which is tied up to the router level. It's basically sit in between your layer 7 router and your application space. So as I said, layer 7 application defense is going to help us keep the bad guys away, and in turn it can increase the availability and it makes the site reliable. As I said, it's embedded at the application router layer. Now, what is so special about the layer 7 application defense? Why can't it be at the different layer, right? If it is in the upper layers, like at the network layer or a different layer, what happens is that we can do mitigation only based on IP address. Because if you go closer to the application, like you sit in the router or near to the router in between the application, then you will have the visibility of the entire incoming request. So you can actually create mitigations not only based on IP and on anything, any user parameter or any request parameter, you can actually do mitigations. I can give an example. Let's say I have a site. I have a rule saying that I will not allow more than 100 requests in a minute from a single IP address. This is the rule I have. And I have a system in place. What if we are all in this room connected to the same Wi-Fi? We all try to access a website. We will get blocked. Some of us will get blocked. Over 100 will get blocked. So this is a pitfall if you try to do this kind of mitigation at a lower level. In turn, in this layer, we can actually do it like, we can actually do based on multiple parameters, right? Like, whatever the problem I stated, right? If you want to drill it down, even one level further, we can actually do mitigation based on email, client ID, account number, anything, right? Anything, you can actually go very closer to the user parameters and then you can do rate limiting or some mitigation. That's a point. So that's what, more closer to the application and then gives more control. That said, let's see what are all the detection strategies which we can build at this layer. It's not just limited to the whatever list I have. Let's see what I've. The first one is the pattern-based mitigation, right? This is like you get the incoming request, and then you first scan all your incoming requests and then try to get some pattern out of it, right? Let's say you find an anomaly pattern. This particular pattern is malicious or bad, whatever, right? you compare it with your incoming request, and the incoming request is also like that, then you treat it differently. When I say differently, you choose to block or you want to do something else, you can do it. That we will cover it in the mitigation strategies. But so this is more closer to what we call it as WAF. WAF stands for Web Application Firewall. So as I said, it's based on the request parameter, right? So very simple example would be like, okay, the header contains a particular string. If the body contains something, then I feel that is this particular request is anomalous, and I'm going to block it, something like that. And not only on the patterns, we can even do this, like on the missing parameters also. Most of our websites, right, we will have some mandatory parameters which will be there in every legitimate request. So when an attacker is attacking our site, he or she may miss that particular piece of information. So we can create a pattern like saying that if this particular piece of information is not in my request, then that is a bad request or a suspicious request, whatever, right? That is one. And then the most effective one is the order of headers, right? See, this is like when a legitimate request comes, right? We expect the headers in a particular order. So sometimes attackers may not follow the particular order of headers. Even we can do pattern out of it. It's not limited only to headers. It can be like query param or even your body structure, right? You can even create an order out of that also. So that's more with the pattern-based detection stuff. The next comes the most common one, the rate or velocity stuff. As I said, like I want to limit only like 100 calls or 200 calls or whatever, right? X number of calls in some Y number of time. I want to do it for a particular IP address or from a particular email or whatnot. So this is called low flying. So why this is called low flying is that, let's say I put a condition saying like more than 100 sign-in attempts to my site in a particular hour from the same IP address, I'm going to block. So what an attacker can do, he can still do 99 calls every hour, and then he can wait till the block is over, and then he can go to the next hour, he can again do another 99 calls, and then he can move on. So that's why this is called low-flying attack. This is effective, but this may cause some hindrance to the legitimate request. As I said, the Wi-Fi example, it will cause some hindrance to the legitimate users. And then the worst attack is something, this is like in case of a DDoS attack, like sub-second attacks that are happening, right? You can actually have some system which can count at the speed of the incoming request, and then you can try to detect the anomalies for the burst attack. That is on very specific to the DDoS attacks. This is a very interesting thing, the reputation feed stuff. So this is like, let's say there is a attacker, if he's attacking a particular site, and he is a repeat offender, right? What if a site or a company try to get the data, and then they build this database or a complete data set of who are all the repeat offenders, who are all the bad traffic which is coming to my site? If that entire information is there, we can feed it to our layer 7 application defense, and then we can stop that request from those IP addresses or from those emails or from those client IDs, account number, whatnot, right? You can just stop it at the layer before even it comes to the actual applications. So this is like you have multiple applications in a company, there will be multiple applications, right? You actually collate all the intelligence and then feed it to a top layer at the router layer and then use it. This is the idea here. But this idea is not limited only to a particular company, right? Let's say there is an attacker, he's attacking a website ABC. Obviously, he's going to attack some other website also if it is in the same sector. What if all the financial companies, if we all can actually share this intelligence, right? Okay, these are the set of repeat offenders to my site. Okay, these are the set of IP addresses or the IP address ranges that we can give. Or these are the email addresses which are compromised in my site. When I say compromised, right? So some breach happened. Because of that breach, someone took those credentials, and then they are trying to log in to those accounts, and then they are trying to do something illegitimate stuff, right? So what if all the companies come together and then share this intelligence? We can actually stop these attacks at a much better rate on the way, and then we can stop these guys away from all the sites. Another interesting stuff, the unverified device. most of the attacks happens from the new device. When I say new device, it is like from that particular device to my site, I have never got a legitimate request. That is what is called a new device, right? So if there is a way, So if we can find out a way to say, like, if this particular device, when I say device, it's not the IP, not the user, right? Exactly the device fingerprint. If from that particular device fingerprint, I have never got legitimate request to my site, then I want to treat that guy differently. Okay, let's say I want a site, there is a new guy coming to my site who never came to my site at all. First time he's coming. I want to treat him differently. When I say differently, you choose to do some mitigations, right? That comes in the next slide. So that's about the unverified device. And the last is machine learning. So whatever the ideas which I talked on the top, right, 1, 2, 3, 4, all these cannot be like manned. We cannot create these policies or maintain these policies by humans, right? So what happens is when we do it by humans, right, attackers are very sophisticated. So by the time you see the attack and then you react to it, the attack would have already caused the damage. So all these policies and rules, whatever ideas which we have, everything should become a machine learning model, and the system should self-learn, and then it should be able to tweak. It can be the pattern, it can be the rate-based policies, or it can be the unverified device stuff. All those things, the system should self-learn, and then it has to detect those anomalies at the layer 7 router. With that said, I will hand over to my friend for the mitigation strategies. Over to him.
Thanks, Vijay. So now let's talk about some of the mitigation strategies. The first one is block. If you see, based on the previous detection strategies which Vijay mentioned, if you see the traffic is bad, absolutely bad, 100% bad, you can go for this block option. If it is a web traffic, you can actually display an error page, or if it is an API traffic, you can go with a HTTP response status code of 429, which is too many requests. Okay. Moving on to CAPTCHA. A quick question here. Do you know which commercial site introduced CAPTCHA? Or when CAPTCHA was introduced? Yeah. Yes, it is PayPal. When? 20 years back, 15 years back, when? Yes, yeah, it is 2001. And it's got introduced by the co-founder, Max Levchin. Yeah, you can actually reach out to us during the breakout session. Sure. Yes. So we go for CAPTCHA. Let's say if you're not sure about the traffic pattern, let's say 10% is legitimate and 20% traffic pattern is bad. So you cannot go for block because you'll be impacting the legitimate traffic. So those cases, we go for CAPTCHA. So what happens when you go for CAPTCHA? Let's just pick a visible category here. The first one is text CAPTCHA, and the other category is the image CAPTCHA. All of you might have seen this, might have came across this. This is nothing new. So CAPTCHAs are designed in such a way that it can be solved by human very easily, and it is very hard for machine. So let's say legit traffic comes and it encounters CAPTCHA. You solve the CAPTCHA, and then you get on with the flow. And if it is from a machine, let's say a curl script or a Python or any bad bot coming in, it gets stuck right there. So that is the idea. Okay, now, quick question again. How many of you actually see CAPTCHAs are good? I love solving CAPTCHA because it helps the site availability. Yes, it does introduce friction to the user experience. There has to be a balance between security and the user experience. So now the industry is actually moving towards the invisible option. a typical example could be a JavaScript-based CAPTCHA, where we throw CAPTCHA based CAPTCHA to a browser, and the browser with a JavaScript-enabled environment, it solves and it get on with the flow. And if it is from a bot, it's stuck there. And a little more advanced version of invisible, which we actually see these days, let's say when the request comes in, okay, your system can have all these browser fingerprints, device fingerprints, as Vijay mentioned, all these all such algorithms, and compute a risk score for that particular request. And let's say the risk score is low, then you don't need to actually introduce friction. So this particular request score is good. Let's not throw CAPTCHA here. Just leave the request as it is. And if the score is low, so that is when you can go for the visible CAPTCHA options. So this reduces the friction, and the industry is actually moving towards invisible CAPTCHA. The other option is TARPIT. So the idea behind TARPIT is you delay the response so that you slow down the attack. One example is, let's say, there is a sign-in attempt with an invalid password, okay? Then you can actually delay the authentication procedure. TARPIT with respect to the network security, an example could be, you delay the incoming connection, okay? So these are some of the mitigation strategies we have. So some of the key takeaways: significant amount of traffic to the internet is bad, and layer 7 is one of the effective layer to mitigate such attacks, and it helps availability and security. The reason being, as Vijay mentioned, it has more data, not just the network layer IP or the attack pattern, only that. It has little more data. And if you look at the holistic view of how the traffic comes to internet to the site, there are multiple layers, right, as Vijay mentioned. There is a WAF layer, web application layer, where, so it's like a funnel. Some of the traffic is actually gets filtered. The bad traffic gets filtered at multiple layers. Let's say web application firewall, network security, then layer 7. Only a very minimal bad traffic goes to the downstream. So the layer 7 defect mitigation mechanism is very important, because the leakage to downstream has to be very, very minimal. Otherwise, the actual downstream application may go down. And so these days, differentiating good versus bad is very, very tough. I mean, see, the attackers are becoming more smart, and we also got to become more smart, one step ahead of attackers, think one step ahead of attackers. So this is always a cat and mouse game. And what is future? Yes, crowdsourcing is one. The fintech companies or similar sectax companies should come together and share data. Even now, it's happening in some areas, but then it is not openly available. It is still a third party and so on, third party products and so on. So I think for a good cause, I think we should come together and share data and help each other. And so typically, as a PD or as a engineers, be it as a DevOps or DevSecOps or whomsoever, let's be proactive in addressing these. So usually security is seen as a checklist or a compliance. Somebody from top down is telling I'm doing it, right? So I think this security is more of a mindset, and that helps your availability, reliability, and brand. So with that, I conclude. And so here is our contact, LinkedIn contact. And we will also be available for questions now, and then even you can catch us up during the breakout session. Thank you. Yep.
Hello. Thanks for the talk. My only question is, like, in the talk you kind of advertised that, like, layer 7 and even like WAF is more sophisticated and you can do much more things with it by filtering the bad traffic. But on the other hand, like, I know that like WAF even is very compute intensive. So
yes,
even the simple pattern matching consumes a lot of resources.
Yes.
and that doesn't play away with attacker because attacker usually scales horizontally. They can acquire resources very cheaply, where you should scale mostly vertically, right? How do you find the balance between like protection and the resource consumption?
It depends on the product, number one, the WAF product. The other one is, it's always a funnel, right? The outer layer has less information, less detection strategies and mitigation strategies. So the attack at outer layers will be actually more. So that is when we want to focus on some of the middle layer where we have more data and we have more mitigation strategies. And even after that, when you talk about security, even after layer 7, we say downstream application, right? Be it a, let's say there is a commercial e-commerce website. It has checkout, right? Before checkout, there are other layers, identity, the authentication system, right? So the sign-in flows. Then comes the risk system. So it is all funnel. Our intention is to actually have the leakage minimal at all layers. But your question is valid. There is no one solve here.
Yeah, sorry. So one answer here, right? So on the computation part, right? So I don't want to give the numbers, but we have. So I won't say it's not. It's actually not intensive, because even the mitigation systems, right? That is also like completely distributed, and it's like really, really we can scale horizontally, right? So we are able to contain the attacker. That's what I would say. Mm-hmm. So it's not that intensive. Maybe it was intensive, like maybe 10 years back, WAF may be not a great solution. But today, if you see, as I said, everything has become distributed and horizontally scalable, right? We can do it in like microseconds.
What I mean is, like, do you have the layer 3 protection in front of the WAF? Or you can like completely scrap layer 3 and just mitigate everything?
No. Definitely not like scrapping layer 3. Mm-hmm. Layer 3, it's going to be a complement. But what the point is that layer 3 can only do very minimal stuff it can do, right? You need bigger some force after layer 3. That's the intent. Yeah. So if you compare, right, what layer 3 does is very minimal compared to what layer 7 can do. Mm-hmm. Layer 7 actually can do wonders, I would say, in this particular availability area.
Thank you.
More questions?
Thank you.
Thank you then.